They were once known as the Concordes of the Seas, mighty flying boats that used to ferry their passengers with speed and style. Hovercraft were a symbol of national innovation and represented the future of transport in the 20th century. And yet, like the Concorde, the huge iconic Mountbatten-class hovercraft that once traversed the 22-mile English Channel from England to France carrying hundreds of passengers and cars are no longer with us. But today, the technology still attracts investment from the world's militaries, industry, and rescue services. These versatile machines have been used in the most inhospitable terrain, defying friction and coasting over obstacles that would be unpassable in other vehicles or ships. Hovercraft are capable of travelling up fast-flowing rivers, over ice caps, on marshes or reclaimed land. 60 years after their invention, they are still found working in the most remote corners of the world. The name hovercraft was originally a trademark held by the British engineering company Saunders-Roe, which produced some of Britain's largest and most successful rotor-propelled vehicles. To avoid the trademark, other manufacturers used the designation ACVs, or air-cushioned vehicles. Whatever name they go by, their distinctive shape is a result of a common principle: to trap a cushion of air beneath the craft, to reduce friction with the ground or waves and achieve high speeds. The man credited with the invention of the hovercraft was the Cambridge-born engineer Christopher Cockerell, who worked on radio technology during the Second World War for the Marconi Company. After leaving Marconi, he bought a small boat hire business and immediately applied his engineering skills to explore ways of making his boats go faster. High-speed watercraft were all over the news at the time, as Donald Campbell's Bluebird had broken the world water speed record four times by 1958, hydroplaning on the calm lakes of Cumbria at 202, then 216, 225, and finally 239 miles an hour, 385 kilometres an hour. These speeds were possible as a result of surface effects that bounced the Bluebird on top of the water like a skimming stone. Cockerell had a different approach. By funneling a curtain of air around the perimeter of the boat's underside, his craft could ride on a cushion of trapped air. The unique advantage of this innovation was that the hovercraft was able to float above the ground even as it was travelling slowly or stopped. Cockerell first tested the concept in his home workshop, channeling air from a vacuum cleaner between two concentric plates, then scaling up the test with a series of larger radio-controlled models. In the autumn of 1958, he sent the design for the world's first prototype hovercraft to the factory at Saunders-Roe. The first working hovercraft was the Saunders-Roe Nautical 1, or SR-N1. This first prototype lacked the skirt of the later models, so as it zoomed across the water, it was often hidden behind a huge wall of spray. Regardless, the media were amazed by the new technology and gave it the nickname the Flying Saucer. On the 25th of July 1959, 50 years to the day after Louis Blériot made the first crossing of the English Channel in a heavier-than-air plane, the SR-N1 set off from Calais to make the first ever hovercraft crossing. As part of a three-man crew, Cockerell himself was on board, his job to provide dynamic ballast by moving himself around on the top of the hovercraft. With a moderate swell and no following winds, the SR-N1 arrived at Dover in 2 hours and 3 minutes. With this success, engineers went to work on refining the design. As on the first channel crossing, the SR-N1 struggled with high winds or over variable slopes. Pilots had to use considerable skill to compensate for the poor steering response. These issues were mitigated with the addition in 1961 of the hovercraft's distinctive skirt, which gave it greater clearance over the ground or waves. By more effectively containing the cushion of air, the SR-N1 could now operate with twice its original weight. This improved carrying capacity also allowed for a turbojet engine to be fitted after the SR-N1, increasing the maximum speed from 35 to 50 knots, 57 miles an hour or 92 kilometers an hour. A series of lightweight hovercraft were developed in the next few years, including the SR-N5, which was licensed to be built by the US military and saw service in the swamps and jungles of Vietnam. The largest hovercraft built at the Saunders-Roe factory was the SR-N4, or the Mountbatten-class, which was four times larger than any of the preceding hovercraft. The first SR-N4, called the Princess Margaret, was originally designed to carry 254 passengers and 30 cars. The four steerable propellers on the roof were the largest in the world, each 19 feet or 6.1 metres across. These were powered by Rolls-Royce Proteus turboprop engines, each using a ton of fuel per hour. The SR-N4 was refitted and expanded twice, growing to a capacity of 60 cars and 418 passengers. That's as many as a 747 airliner. The main ferry route was between Dover and Boulogne, a 22-mile trip which took on average just 35 minutes. However, when unloaded, the SR-N4 could go even faster, and the unofficial record for a cross-channel crossing was a blistering 15 minutes and 23 seconds. However, as the speed limit on the English Channel is 70 miles an hour, this was never officially recognised. The Princess Margaret was also immortalised in the 1971 James Bond film Diamonds Are Forever, in which Sean Connery embarked from Dover aboard the new Mountbatten ferry. The Channel's hovercraft service had its peak year in 1986, when 3 million passengers made the crossing. However, by October 2000, the route was closed, in part due to competition from the new Channel Tunnel Rail service. But by other accounts, it was the end of the duty-free service in 1999 that made the hovercraft uneconomical. At this point, sales from tax-free products on board were making more profit than the ticket receipts, and as spare parts ran out, the SR-N4 was retired. A petition in 2016 to save an SR-N4, the Princess Anne, for display in the Hovercraft Museum near Portsmouth in the UK was successful, and the progress of restoring one of the giant Mountbatten hovercraft continues this year. Christopher Cockerell envisioned a future where we would cross the Atlantic in huge nuclear-powered hovercraft. However, this wasn't to be. Rising oil prices in the 1970s had meant on many routes, more economical hydrophiles and catamarans offered better profit margins. However, in rough terrain and inhospitable environments, the hovercraft still can't be matched, and has been developed for the world's elite amphibious military units. The largest ever hovercraft is a thoroughly modern military vessel, the Zubr-class air-cushioned landing craft. Zubr is 57 metres long, or 187 feet, 1 metre longer than the SR-N4, but can carry a much greater load, up to 550 tonnes. This means that it can land 3 tanks, or 8 armoured personnel carriers with 375 troops onto a beach. Zubr was designed in the 1980s by the Soviet regime to match the capabilities of the American LCAC military hovercraft. It comes equipped with an active system for hiding its magnetic field, a kind of stealth mode for avoiding magnetic influence mines. In the case of a nuclear or chemical strike, the crew can seal off their living quarters and continue their operations. In 2009, China announced that they would purchase 4 Zubr-class boats for $350 million each, and since then, they have been granted a license to build further derivatives themselves. With Chinese interests in the disputed territories in the South China Sea, huge hovercraft like the Zubr set to remain front and centre in the world stage for years to come. So thanks for watching, and this episode's shirt was the Trip Paisley Surf Retro by Madcap England, which is available from Atom Retro with worldwide shipping from here in the UK. We also have the Curious Droid Facebook page, the link is in the channel page, and I would like to thank all of our Patreons for their ongoing support. And if you would like to support us, then please visit our Patreon page in the link. So as always, thanks again for watching, and please subscribe, rate, and share.